Good morning. This is an important message this morning, and it's about standards. And you know standards are important. But when I was growing up, there was a whole different set of standards back then. And today, there's another whole different set of standards. Standards change all the time. But there's one constant that never changes, and that's God's standard for our life. Stay tuned. I think you're going to enjoy this message. Everybody bowing your head, nobody looking around. Father, thank you, thank you, thank you for another season, another opportunity to come into your house and to worship you and give you the honor, glory, and praise, Father, that you so richly deserve. Bless our service. Bless each one that came in here today to honor you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Turn up just a little bit.
Indeed, the Lord has proclaimed to the end of the world. Say to the daughter of Zion, surely your salvation is coming. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. And they shall call them the holy people, the redeemed of the Lord. And you shall be called sought out, a city not forsaken.
Amen.
Do our first hymn when the operator gets it going there.
Oh, that's funny.
What a wonderful change in my life has it wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul for a song I have sung since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into
we do have a small prayer list this week, but we do have. Now, if you have anybody that needs to be on it, make sure you let me know. Let Barbara know, she can write her down. Oh, okay. I'm going to sell you them later. For a buck. But you paid for them already. The church ordered them, so I'm just going to resell them. Okay, on our prayer list today,
Writer Stephen. Stevens is a 7-year-old boy, and it is my, well, it's Betsy's ex-stepdaughter. So Krista's been kind of our granddaughter. Who had a stroke. From that, they found out he had a cancerous brain tumor. They removed 60% of it. He knows he had a tumor. He knows that he's doing radiation chemo. They have not told him that he only has about 6 months. So they need prayer.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. That's a tough thing. Judy Livingston is on our prayer list. Keep her in your prayers. Anybody else have them that we can mention now?
Can we put Lindsay Stevens and her family and the whole Addison community? They lost their son to suicide a couple weeks ago.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Anybody else? Got anything? Okay. Let's ask the Lord. Father, we are bringing these people before you, asking, Lord, your hand, comfort, and peace upon them. There's tragedy everywhere in our church, in our family. Lord, we pray for those who need comfort, that you comfort them, and healing for those who need healing. You are the great comforter. We bring this before your altar and ask for your hand upon them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, it's your turn.
Rest that endures. Earth has no can't heal. There's no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All are broken, lift up your veins. Oh, wonder God, you're not too far.
Mexican theme.
It's
so
bring what you want.
Yeah.
Mexican theme.
Yeah, Mexican theme. Bring what you want. Mexican potato salad would be nice.
What?
There's no such
thing.
Yeah, yeah, throw some jalapenos in it. Call it Mexican. Alright.
Brian. If this works, we're gonna do another hand.
Jesus, I surrender all.
went into the insurance company. He wanted to get some health insurance. So the agent took him over to his desk there and said, I got some standard questions I want to talk to you about. He says, first thing, he says, have you ever been in an accident? Cowboy says, nope, nary one. He's from Texas, you know, that's what he taught me. He says, you sure you've never been in an accident? He said, yeah, I've never been in an accident. He said, well, it says on this pre-form that you filled out that you were bitten by a snake. He said, don't you think that was an accident? He cowboy said, heck no, that varmint bit me on purpose. It's just a little, you'll laugh later, I'm sure. So we're talking about standards, and I used the word standard in that little joke there. And there are lots of standards. There are standards for education, standards for living, moral standards, you know, the old right and wrong thing. The definition of a standard, according to Webster's Dictionary, a standard is something established as a rule or basis for comparison. And we're going to discuss both of those, the standard and a rule and comparison for standard. For example, standards are used for guidelines to govern students. What that means is what they learn in school. They have standards. They have to meet certain criteria in school. Well, now, standards change. Because I know this for a fact. Because what I learned in school isn't what taught in school today. It's changed. Like, when I was going to school, they had home ec. They don't have home ec today. So, standards vary. They change, they fluctuate, but they never stay the same. There are guidelines. When you're growing up as a child, or when you have your children, you have guidelines. My parents had guidelines for me. Things I had to do, things I couldn't do, things I should do that I didn't do. But growing up, there was boundaries, rules that I had to follow. Standards. Now, we had standards, Barbara and I, for our kids. For example, whatever grade they were in was the time that they had to be home. If they were in the 8th grade, they had to be home by 8 o'clock at night. If they were in the 10th, 10 o'clock, 12 o'clock. That rule never changed. It was carved in stone. It was the standard that we set for our kids to keep them what? Safe. Make sure they were home 12 o'clock. After that, I didn't care. Do what you want. But them are standards. When I was in the service, I had to go through basic training. That was not fun. Not fun. But they had rules. I remember crawling underneath barbed wire with live rounds shooting over the top of me. I had to learn how to throw a grenade. Things that they taught me, rules and standards, that was to keep me safe when I went overseas. So, what am I saying? I'm saying there are standards, and they're in place, one for education, two for morals and things right and wrong, but to keep us grounded, keep us headed in the right direction. That being said, and we should set, keep getting off track, but that's okay. I'm the preacher. There, we should set our own standards. Brian's standards will be different than Ron's standards. Jason, what are you doing? setting his own standards, I know. And Jason's may be different than Chris's. because each of us are individual. We have different DNAs. And so your standards for yourself will not be the same as somebody else's. So where do you get your standards? How do you know what standard is right for you, which is not right for you? The thing is, it's like this. If you're setting standards in your life, or take for instance, if you want a pizza, you don't go to a donut shop, okay? So if you're setting standards in your life, where do you want to go? Where would you find them? Duh, I just happen to have a copy.
The Bible.
The Bible. You know what? Like I said, standards change. But the great news is God's standards never do. They have stayed the same for centuries. Nothing changes with them. It is always the same. What he says is true. What he says is carved in stone. It doesn't change. Our government would be a lot better off if we had standards that didn't change. You know, if God can do it for thousands and thousands of years, why can't we do it? Because standards change. It's a given. It's just the way it is. God's standards never change. Brian read Isaiah 62 or 63 or 4, whatever it was. We finally found it. It says, go through the gates, prepare ye the way of the people, cast up the highway, gather out the stones, lift up a standard for my people. That's what my Bible read. Now the Living Bible says it this way. Go out through the gates, prepare the highway for my people. To return, soothe the roads, pull out the boulders, raise a flag as a standard for all nations to see. This message was being taught to the house of Israel. They were in captivity at the time. And so God is releasing them, freeing them from their captivity, and they are to immediately head back to the promised land, land flowing with milk and honey, so it says in Exodus 3:8. Now, on their way, they are to clear a path. So why have they got to clear this path? For those who will come after them. And that wasn't only a command for them to clear the way. It is also a command for us. The Bible is never, it doesn't have a timeline. It's timeless. And so what he's telling them, he's also telling us. We are, as Christians, to clear a way for those who are coming behind us. They don't even know it yet. Your actions, our actions, as a church and as individuals, will help or hinder a person who sees us. In Florida, I use that example of you're in Walmart, what a place to be. And you got your shopping cart, and there's probably about 30 people in front of you, and that's in the speedy lane. And you're having a fit. And then you get up to the teller, finally reach the teller, and she can't get a price on a certain item you have, so she's got to get a price check. And you're fit to be tied. Now, what is your actions? What about the person who is standing behind you? What are they thinking when they see you? Do I want to be like that person? Do I want to act like that person? Clearing a path means having a good attitude. Clearing boulders out of the way means when people look at us, they won't see our bits of whatever. That's what the passage is telling us. Isaiah 62:11. Behold, the Lord has proclaimed unto the end of the earth, say ye to the daughters of Zion, behold, the salvation cometh. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. Now, the daughter of Zion, people, is us, Christians. That's who he's talking to. He's already talked to the house of Israel. Now he's talking to us. He says, the Messiah is coming, and he's bringing with him salvation and forgiveness of our sins. That's great news. That's great news. His reward will be everlasting life to those who believe. Excuse me. Verse 12. For ye dare not make ourselves a number or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves. But they measure themselves by themselves, and comparing themselves among themselves are not wise. Now we're into that comparison part of the description I gave you. Now we're into comparing. What is wrong with that? Well, when we brag on ourselves, there's not much to brag on, got it? when we pat ourselves on the back, nobody's going to listen. Because you're just showing off, or you're just being a show off. So, but Paul says in 1 Corinthians, he says, he refuses to be that kind of a person. What kind of a person? He's talking to the false teachers, those in his day. Sadducees, the Pharisees, and all those C's. And he's saying that he is not like them. And he don't want us to be like them. Because what are they doing? It said they were comparing themselves to themselves. They thought highly of themselves. They were the most self-religious people there was. They thought they were God and nobody else could compare. Paul says, that's not right. They had... When you look at yourself and you think yourself better than somebody else or more religious than somebody else, you're patting yourself on the back. You're making yourself a God. In other words, Paul reminds his readers, that's us, that God's word is the standard. It is the only standard, by the way. No other standard matters. God's standard in our lives means more than anything else. Even our own standard. Remember I told you we were to make standards for ourselves? If you do it the proper way, if you go to the Word of God, you can set standards. And like I said, everybody, when you read Scripture, let's take the Scripture we read this morning. Brian read it. He interpreted it one way. I would read it. The Spirit would say, okay, this is what you need out of this. So it would give me something, a little different point of view, a little different look at it. But setting a standard for yourself, if you do it with the Word of God, then you can't go wrong, at least you shouldn't go wrong. It's human nature to seek confirmation for ourselves. We want a that-a-boy when we do something good. We want praise when we do something right. We want evidence. You know, we're a proud people. And it's not uncommon. It's human nature. That if we do something, like when I'm done preaching here, I'm going to go back to the door. And I want every one of you, when you walk out, say, great preaching, her. Great preaching, preacher. Yeah, see? That's not what I want, really. But that's the example of what he was saying that the Pharisees and the Sadducees were talking about. They were comparing themselves to themselves. There was nobody else to compare to. They didn't believe in God. And so who would they have to compare themselves to? Themselves. And they were all high and mighty. They were all proud and looking at themselves and were pious. The world standard, hear me now, the world standard will tell us that we need to achieve certain benchmarks in life to be happy, to be successful, to enjoy life. Why? Because one benchmark, and you know, that's a crock. Why? Because one benchmark after another, one goal after another that has been achieved and the next one comes along, doesn't satisfy us. It doesn't satisfy us. The only way we can truly obtain happiness is through the Word of God, through believing in Christ, through salvation. Because chasing somebody else's benchmark, all the while we're chasing theirs, we're missing our own. And if God is the standard in our life, if that is what we follow, if that is the rule that we follow, then whatever else the world tells you is wrong. Whatever else the world says you need to do, whatever else people tell you you need to do to be successful is wrong. Jesus died so we could stop chasing like a dog chasing his tail. That's what it is. When you follow the world, you're like a dog chasing his tail, around in a circle. Around in a circle. God says, live according to my standard. Take the road less traveled. His road, his way, his standards. Okay? It's like the more time we spend with him, the more anchored we will become in our life. The more suicide in this country is running rampant. It is out of control. And I bring that up only to say that when you get up in the morning and you look in the mirror, do you like what's looking back at you? Do you like what you see? People get up in the morning and they don't even want to look at them. They can't stand what's looking back at them. Setting standards, living the way God wants us to live, the narrow road, the wide, the world says, here it is, take it all, it's yours. God says, the narrow road is my way. Our prayer this morning should be that our measure of righteousness, our standard, would be fixed on Christ. That should be our focus. What he did on the cross, the sacrifice he made on the cross, that should be our goal. One thing in closing. What all this was about today, what all I was talking about, is about us as a church, family, and as individuals. Standards in our life. God was talking to Israel. They were leaving captivity, going to a land flowing with milk and honey. And what did he say? He said, make sure that what obstacles are in your way, pull them out, get rid of them, because those who follow you will stumble if you don't. They'll trip, fall, and they won't get up. So this message, this one, is watch how we live, because people are watching us. We need to make sure that when we're out, and even when you're in, that our attitude and our lives are Christ-like. That's what the message is about. Standards. Not just our standards, God's standards. And if we live by His standards, then we'll be a light for all to see. Prayer time. There it is. Father, we thank you for your living word, which should guide our lives perfectly, not just haphazardly, perfectly. And for your Son and the sacrifice he made on the cross, which grants us grace to interpret the word as the Spirit leads us. Forgive us, Lord, for going our own way. Bless our lives. But we know your way is a bigger, better way than ours. Put, Lord, pull out the stumbling blocks in our way so that others may follow us. We have stumbling blocks ourselves. And sometimes they're boulders. We can't move them. So we pray your hand upon us. Help us, Lord. Help others follow you. To lead others to you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Did it, Maestro?
Oh,
wouldn't have been anything if you weren't present in this house. Your spirit feeding us, giving us your grace. Lord, it would not be right if we didn't give a chance to know you to somebody here that may not know you. And so we're going to do what we call the Lord's Prayer. It's a simple prayer. It's a prayer of salvation. It goes like this. Say it to yourself. Repeat it after me. Father, I know I'm a sinner. Lord, the best way I know how, I ask you to come into my life. I open the door to my heart. I ask you to come in. Forgive me of my sins. Father, when I die and leave this world, the only place I want to go is to heaven, to sit around the throne of grace and to praise you, praise you, praise you. Thank you for the service today. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
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 Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.